This conference will now be recorded.
So we're talking about colonic neoplasia, and the first part of colonic neoplasia will be the colorectal polyps. We'll talk about the colorectal polyps today. Acknowledgements and disclosures as usual. Now coming to colorectal polyps, how do we define a polyp? So polyp is basically a non-specific term. It doesn't mean a disease in itself. As means basically any projection from an inner mucosal surface occurring as an isolated or in cluster. It could be solitary or multiple. That basically, it could be pedunculated, or it could be sessile without a peduncle, or it could be absolutely flat, raised surface of the mucosa. It could be sporadic, or it could be as a part of an inherited syndrome. 90-95% of benign. This is a very important fact, because the immediately what comes to mind when you have a polyp is probably we have a malignancy. The chance of having malignancy in a polyp is about only 5-10%. The sex almost equal in certain instances, but by and large the females are more involved. The males are more involved than the females, and it has to be differentiated from mucosal hemangiomas or lipomas or submucosal polyp. These are basically raised above the surface. So they have to be differentiated. Now let's look at the site-wise distribution. If you look at site-wise distribution, you'll find that the rectum is the most common site to be involved, almost in 33.5% cases. The next in line is sigmoid colon, 22.9%. And then as you travel backwards, descending colon, transverse colon, and perhaps the least common, you find it in cecum. There are hardly any polyps reported in cecum. Now, epidemiological factors carrying them on. The age-wise distribution, you find that above 40 years, there was a significant increase in the prevalence of polyps. That means basically, it has to do with the higher age group. And if you look at the maximum incidence, you'll find the maximum incidence is in more than 70 years age group. Less than 30 years, you have a very, very low incidence of polyps, unless and until it's a part and parcel of an inherited syndrome. Otherwise, you find them, the sporadic polyp, you find them maximally more than 70 years. The incidence age-wise is given out here. Now, colonoscopically, if you're doing a colonoscopic examination in a population for screening, you'd pick up 100 patients and you just carry out a colonoscopic examination, you'll find that the positivity rate is somewhere in the region of 14-30%. If you look at the Indian figures, 2% of the population would be having colonic polyps. And as opposed to the Western counterpart, they occur in relatively younger patients. The etiological factors, most commonly idiopathic, but there are certain risk factors which can be singled out. Like, for example, in lifestyle of a particular patient, the diet makes a difference. Diet which is high in red meat and fat, increased incidence of polyps, low in fiber and folic acid, an obese person and lack of exercise, cigarette smoking, alcohol consumption, they are all propagative factors for increased incidence of polyps. The other group are the genetic predisposition, and more commonly seen in black populations, and in hereditary polyposis syndromes, among which there are a number of syndromes. So these are all hereditary polyposis syndromes. Histologically and behavior wise, they have been classified. So this classification is important. Hyperplastic, hamartomatous, neoplastic, and inflammatory. Now, hyperplastic are also known as metaplastic, and they are the second most common polyps, 20%. The hamartomatous polyps, we'll just define them in a short while. The juvenile, Sudzegers, Cronkite Canada syndrome, and others. These are not the only two ones, the others also, we'll list them later on. Neoplastic, which are perhaps the more problematic or the most sinister, I would like to call it. Among them, you've got the adenomas, you've got the adenocarcinomas and the carcinoid. We'll be dealing with this subclassification later on also, but here just to point out that among the 70% of adenomas, they're tubular villous adenomas in the order of occurrence. Then you've got the tubular adenomas, the least common is the villous adenoma, and you've got the serrated adenoma. This is a new classification or new entrant to this classification, the serrated adenoma. And last is the group of inflammatory polyps, which are not really polyps, they're pseudopolyps, where you find that the mucosa, edematous mucosa, along with an ulcer, appears as a polyp. And that's why it's commonly seen in ulcerative colitis, where they are multiple and need to be differentiated from adenomas, benign lymphoid, groin diverticulitis, etc., etc. Now, this is a very good classification of intestinal polyps. I think you should note it down. The mucosal polyps and the submucosal polyps. And you got the mucosal polyps, the non-neoplastic, the benign, and the malignant. And then you got the submucosal polyps. Remember the first slide that I showed you, where these polyps have to be differentiated from those cases where you got the raising of the mucosa because of submucosal lesion. And these submucosal lesions, basically lipomas, leiomyomas, you can have a cystic lesion underneath, you can have a pneumatosis, cystoides intestinalis, which basically is nothing but air trapped inside the submucosa. You can have a lymphoid aggregates, lymphomas, carcinoid. So these are those which are mimicking polyps. That's why they have been pushed as a submucosal polyp. But the true polyps are these group, the non-neoplastic, the benign, and the malignant. So non-neoplastic, neoplastic, neoplastic benign, and neoplastic malignant. Okay, so that's how you differentiate. So this is a classification of the intestinal polyp. Now coming to the second most common, we said, remember, 20%. So what are these metaplastic or hyperplastic polyposes, or what are these polyps? They're always less than about 5 millimeters. So they're very, very small polyps, usually in the colon, not so commonly in the rectum. The sessile flat with the papillary surface, the color is usually tan colored, and histologically, if you look at the histological features, you find the funnel shape, non-branching mucosal crypts, cuboidal cells at the base. If they are more than 2 centimeters, they may be premalignant. So by and large, the metaplastic hyperplastic polyps are usually non-malignant unless and until they assume a size of more than 2 centimeters, which is a very rare occurrence. Why? Because more commonly they are less than 5 millimeters in size. Now coming to the most important, and that is the hamartomatous polyps. The term, because I would say most common, these were the second most commonest, hamartomatous polyps. Now they occur as a sporadic event or a syndromic event. Sporadic basically means that this is occurring as a random. They do not have any kind of genetic predisposition. When you call a syndromic, that basically means it's occurring as a part of a widespread syndrome. That basically means it has to have a genetic origin, because that particular gene is affecting other organs also. That's why it becomes syndromic. So when you talk about a sporadic type, it can occur in the juvenile age group, it can occur in the adult age group. Syndromic, mainly three types: Sudzegger, juvenile polyposis syndrome, and PTN syndrome. Minor ciliation, other syndromes are also there, but they are less important. But these three syndromes are the main three hamartomatous polyposis syndromes. Now, coming to the term hamartoma, what do we really mean by hamartoma? I think this is just going back to a lecture in pathology, but just it would help us to review what basically we are talking about when we are saying a hamartomatous one. Now, the word hamartoma arises from a Greek word hamartia, translated as a failure. So they're basically talking about a failure. That basically means a tumor made from malformed cells, considered a developmental error. So that's why it's known as a failure. So you are basically talking about a tumor arising from malformed cells. So it resembles a neoplasm, but grows at the same rate as a normal cell. It is just that the cell has become abnormal, but the growth rate is exactly like a normal cell. Right? So that is what a hamartoma is all about. Fortunately, hamartomas are not very common, and they can occur as sporadic or syndromic, as we just now detailed. There's a minimal risk of CRC. Now, remember, why are we worried about polyps? Every polyp has to be seen in the light of a future development of colorectal cancer. CRC is colorectal cancer. So that is why whenever we talk about a polyp, the incidence of risk of, or the risk of CRC has to be taken into consideration every time. Now, these hamartomatous polyps as a whole, histologically, they would be characterized by both glandular and stromal events, elements. Easy to understand. Why? Because they're normal tissue. They're normal deformed cells. So the glandular cells are there, stromal element is there. There's a marked vascularity because the growth is very fast as compared to the marked vascularity because the deformity of the cells. It contains mucus-filled glands covered with thin rectal cuboidal epithelium. So the glandular the part is the mucus-filled glands with cuboidal epithelium. Retention cysts may be found. Abundant connective tissue. That's the stromal element. and a chronic cellular infiltration. So apart from the natural habitat cells, you also have cells coming from outside. And these are eosinophils, the lymphocytes, plasma cells, and polymorphonuclear leukocytes. Now, coming to the sporadic type. So this was basically an overview of what a hematomatous polyp means. Now, when you talk about a sporadic type of hematomatous polyp, the most common is a juvenile polyp. It can occur in the pediatric population or it can occur in the adult population. So pediatric juvenile hematomatous polyp is usually solitary, and this is the most common polyp in the children. Most common polyp, and that is where it gets this importance. Why? Because you get a lot of patients in the age group of anywhere between 2 to 5 or even up to 10 come with PR bleed, and when you put the finger inside, do a TRE examination, you find a polyp there. So the most common polyp in a child, almost 70 to 90% colonoscopically diagnosed, are pediatric juvenile hematomatous polyps, which are sporadic, meaning there's no genetic predisposition to it. Okay, the term juvenile here refers to the type of polyp and not the age of the onset of polyp. This is to be remembered. That's very important, because juvenile basically means refers to age, but here juvenile is referring to the pathological type, not to the age. Most frequently diagnosed in the first 10 years. Just now told you the peak incidence 2 to 5, but can occur up to 10 years. Approximately 50% of children with juvenile polyps have more than one polyp. So why is this fact important? Because when you do a DRE examination, you localize the polyp and you're happy, put your finger out, stop the DRE examination and prescribe that, yes, this patient got a rectal polyp, you should get operated. What you tend to forget is that in 50% of these patients, there would be a second polyp higher up. So remember, if you have diagnosed or if you have identified one polyp, either colonoscopically or a DRE examination, always go and look for a second polyp if it is there. Mainly rectal, 1 to 3 centimeters in size, and 90% are pedunculated. They're all very, very characteristic features of a polyp identified in a child of 2 to 5 years of age. No increased risk of colorectal carcinoma. That is a very big relief, and you can easily advise the attendants, the patient, that look, this is not cancer. It cannot turn into cancer, but because of troublesome bleeding, you have to have it removed. The pediatric juvenile hematomatous polyp. Further, if you look histologically, typical juvenile polyp, we just now said, it has got both glandular and connective tissue elements. So here also, distinctive cystic architecture, mucosal glands, and a prominent lamina propria and dense infiltration with inflammatory cells. Now, these findings have led to overlapping terminology. Why? Because these findings have inflammatory cells, it is called mucosal gland. So these are overlapping findings. And that is why these polyps, which are hematomatous juvenile polyps, they have also been named as inflammatory, retention, hyperplastic, depending on the dominant histological finding. Whichever histological finding, like for example, if the inflammatory cells are more, they like to call it inflammatory polyp. Okay, so these are the overlapping terminology that has to be remembered. But by and large, if you look at the primary terminology, it would be a sporadic juvenile hematomatous polyp. Is that clear? Now, the usual presentation of these polyps in this child of 2 to 5 years of age is a bleeding, which is the most common. There could be a prolapse. It's a very common history. And you ask the child, you ask the child if the child is communicative enough, or you ask the attendant of the child that during defecation, does something come out and go back in? And more often than not, they'll be able to tell you, yes, something comes out and it goes back in, or I have to report it back. That is a very, that's indicative of a rectal polyp. Of course, the further questionnaire would really mean or would extend to whether the whole circumference is coming out, or you find an isolated protrusion through the perirectal area. Why? Because you want to differentiate from a mucosal interception or a mucosal prolapse, right? So you have to differentiate a rectal a polyp coming out from a rectal prolapse. So that is why a proper history is important. But by and large, these polyp patients present only with bleeding and prolapse, and very rarely with interception if it is found high enough. If solitary, the easiest method is a transanal polypectomy, which we usually practice as an open method or as a colonoscopic polypectomy. The adult type of sporadic juvenile polyposis, in a retrospective study over 11-year period, they found that only 0.15% colonoscopic patients had sporadic hamartoma. That basically means that it is not a common occurrence in the adult age group. These sporadic juvenile polyps are most common in the 2 to 5 years of age group, up to 10 years, right? In this age group, it is very rare and found usually at 55 years. Most common indication of colonoscopic in these patients was rectal bleeding, which basically means that they also present most commonly with a rectal bleeding. So in a patient 55 years of age or around 50 years of age presenting with rectal bleeding, one of the types of polyps that he could be having could be a hamartomatous juvenile polyp, right? Most of them are located in the rectal sigmoid, and 36% of these patients would be having a concomitant adenomatous polyp. That means a second polyp would be there in 36% of these patients. And in all those affected, there was only one hamartomatous polyp per person. Sporadic single hamartomatous polyps are not thought to increase the risk of cancer. So remember, hamartomatous juvenile polyps are hardly ever going to change in malignancy. So that was the sporadic part of hamartomatous. Now coming to the syndromic hamartomatous polyps. Now, as I told you earlier, three main syndromes: juvenile polyposis syndrome, Sudzegger syndrome, and the PTEN syndrome, or the phosphatase and tensin homolog deleted on chromosome 10. That is the full form of PTEN associated hamartomatous syndromes. So that is the PTEN associated syndromes, and among them, the common ones, the Cowden syndrome and the Rilly syndrome, or the BRR syndrome. Think of Banyan, Rilly, Rubalcaba syndrome. So that these are the syndromes which are related to the PTEN deletion. Now, all of them are autosomal dominant inherited disorders. All of them. That's what I told you, that sporadics are hardly ever familial, hardly ever genetic. But as opposed to that, syndromic are always genetic, and they have got autosomal dominant inherited disorders. Occasionally, apart from these three, remember I told you that these are the most common, but occasionally they can occur, these syndromic hamartomatous polyps can also occur as a part of a large white fluid syndrome where the polyps are just playing a minor role. Like, for example, neurofibromatosis type 1, von Recklinghausen disease, also known as von Recklinghausen disease. You can have MEN type 2B, you can have basal cell nevus syndrome, also known as Gorlin syndrome. So in these, the polyps are not the major players, they are minor players. But in these, the polyps are the major player, that they are the presenting features. In these, they are not the presenting features, they're just bystanders. They are there, right? So they are just a minor role to play in the other ones, right? So coming to the syndromic one, among the syndromic, remember I told you the three types, the juvenile polyposis, Sudzegger, and PTEN. Let's talk about the juvenile polyposis syndrome. That is opposed to the sporadic juvenile polyp that we just now talked about in the sporadic group of hamartomatous. Now we talk about the syndromic juvenile polyposis. Usually present the first 2 decades of life. There it was, remember what? Below 10 years or 55 years if it is the adult type. Here it is present in the first 2 decades of life. Family history would be found in 75%. And these are associated with two genetic, I told you they are all genetic. So two genetic mutations have been identified, and both the genes are part of the transforming growth factor or the bone morphogenetic protein, right? So just remember they got genetic mutations. If you don't want to remember these genes, forget them. But just remember first 2 decades of life, family history 75%, and two genetic mutations. Increased risk of GI carcinomas. Remember, just now remember, sporadic juvenile, no risk of GI cancers, or very, very rare risk of CR cancer. But here, if it is a familial juvenile polyposis syndrome, both the risk of other parts of GI and colorectal carcinoma increase. So there's increased risk of all around GI cancers, including CR. Not only CR, that is colorectal, it's also GI cancer. A clinical diagnosis of juvenile polyposis syndrome is considered. So when do you want to diagnose it clinically? Of course, you can have a genetic diagnosis, but that takes time. So when do you say clinically that the patient has got a familial juvenile polyposis syndrome? When you have at least one of these three criteria, that is at least 3 juvenile polyps of the colon, multiple juvenile polyps found throughout the GIT, and or any number of juvenile polyps with a family history of JPS. So if you got a family history of JPS, even if you got one polyp, it means you've got familial juvenile polyposis syndrome. The symptoms, minimal, or if they do present with symptoms, it's bleeding, obstruction, diarrhea, and leading to anemia and potentially protein losing enteropathies. Why? Because diarrhea, you lose a lot of proteins and you lose a lot of electrolytes, and that's why these patients are usually anemic and they've got protein losing enteropathy. Surveillance is important in this group of patients, and colonoscopy and upper endoscopy both. Remember, see, this is important. Not only colonoscopy, even upper GI endoscopy is important at the age of 12 to 15 years of age. That means this is the time when these present. That's why I said most commonly first 2 decades. Repeat annually if polyps are found. So at the age of 12 to 15, if you happen to find a polyp in a patient who's suspected to be having a familial GPS syndrome, then you have to repeat the colonoscopy annually. If no polyps are found, you can repeat that colonoscopy after 2 to 3 years. So don't do it annually, do it after 2 to 3 years until the age of 20 years or 30 years. We'll just come to that. The treatment is similar to other hematomatous familial polyps, and these are syndromic polyps, and that is endoscopic polypectomy with the help of a colonoscope or sigmoidoscope or rectoscope, whatever the polyp is. So in the rectum, sigmoid or colon, you use a rectoscope, you can use a sigmoidoscope, you can use a colonoscope. Or else, if you find that it is not feasible to remove it endoscopically, or you find a malignant histology on one of the biopsies, do not go ahead and do endoscopic polypectomy. In that case, you'll have to do a total abdominal colectomy or total proctocolectomy. So either a total colon removal or colon along with rectum removal, which will be known as proctocolectomy, with or without reconstruction. That depends upon, we'll talk about what this basically means, because these are standard operations for any kind of polyp. So these standard operations we'll talk about when we talk about the malignancy part. Now, the second syndromic polyp we need to know about is, which is perhaps more famous and more commonly known, is the Schutzeger syndrome, characterized by oral melanosis, lip melanosis. That means in and around the oral cavity, you got melanosis at two sites. One, the lip, and number two, the oral cavity. That means the oral mucosa. Hematomatous polyps, mainly the small bowel, plus minus melanosis of the perianal skin and digits. So you got melanosis of the oral cavity, including lip and oral mucosa, melanosis of the perianal skin, digits, along with that, hematopoietic polyps, mainly of the small bowel. They can also be there in the colonic, but characteristically, they are in the small bowel. Autosomal dominant, we said all syndromic familial hematopoietic polyps are all autosomal dominant. So here also, it's autosomal dominant. Here, the gene which is involved is the STK 11 gene found on chromosome 19, as opposed to the GPS syndrome we just talked about, where there were two genes. Here it is one gene which is involved. And in a Schutzeger syndrome, what is characteristic is that you have other GI cancers, like example stomach, along with colorectal cancer. You also have gynecological cancers, cervical, ovarian. You have breast cancer, pancreatic cancer, and testicular cancer. So Schutzeger syndrome is characterized by all these things. A proper thorough screening for all the above is a must. Histologically similar tree-like or frond-like smooth muscle outgrowth with normal covering mucosa. Malignant transformation, I told you, every poly has to have this note attached to it. Malignant transformation in a Schutzeger, rare but can occur, right? Signs and symptoms, GI bleed, interception. Treatment, again, polypectomy or enterectomy. If you find a particular isolated segment of small bowel to be involved, go ahead and remove it. Now, coming to those syndromic, other associated with PTEN syndrome, these are the Conkeny, Canada syndrome, where you have all these things. I'm not going to go into details of that. Or you can have a Cowden syndrome. All of them are, again, autosomal dominant. And you have got the various associated clinical presentations in these. Now, coming to the most important group, why most important? For the sake of occurrence, number one, and number two, for the sake of subsequent development of CRC, that is colorectal cancer. Now, coming to the neoplastic polyps, and these are known as adenomas, and they are classified as tubular, tubulovillous, villous, and serrated. Remember the first slide that I showed you in the classification of types of polyps? So among all polyps in the colon, you have the neoplastic polyps, and the adenomas are perhaps the most common presenting feature. In the younger age group, it is the juvenile polyp. But taken as a whole, it is the adenoma which is the most common polyp presenting. Among the adenomas, the tubular adenoma has, how to classify a tubular tubulovellus ovalus? That is basically classified on the basis of the amount of dysplasia. So if you have got up to 20% dysplastic epithelium arranged as tubules, it is known as tubular, and the malignant potential is 10%. If you have got a mixed adenoma, that basically means both tubular and villous element, and how do you know that? More than 20% but less than 80% of dysplastic villous forms, right? This is the most common type of adenoma form. Pre-malignant, if less than 1 centimeter, malignant potential is 20%. A villous, purely villous, which is classified as that having more than 80% dysplastic villous epithelium. So when you're doing a histology, you have to identify if the villous epithelium is there or not. Less than 20%, you'll call it a plain and simple tubular. If you have 20 to 80% of villous forms, tubulovillus. More than 80%, it's a pure villous form. And there, it is frond-like, large, and the malignant potential is 40%. See the exponential rise, 10%, 20%, and 40%. A serrated adenoma, this was the recent entrant into the classification of neoplastic polyps. So what is it all about? Serrated adenoma could be any of these, could be any of these. Basically, what is here is that there are 50% of dysplastic tissue showing serrations. Now, what does it basically mean, serrations? Let's talk about where they're usually found. Right colon, rectum, sessile, malignant potential 5%. See, is the least of all these. This was 10, 20, 40, 5%. Histologically, what is the serration? It is a crenated sawtooth. You have seen the saw with which you saw the wood. So it's a sawtooth-like configuration due to the scalloped epithelial infolding. So basically what's happening is you've got a normal epithelium, it scallops. So when it scallops, it becomes something like this. So that scalloped epithelium would appear like serration. So one you got here, one you got here. So this, what is rising, is appearing as the teeth of the saw. So that is what is giving the crenated sawtooth-like configuration that is displayed on the epithelium covering the sides of the crypts of Lippocott. Smaller serrated adenomas, only cells at the lower part of the crypts were dysplastic. If you got a large serrated adenoma, the dysplastic epithelium even extends up to the upper part of the crypts. Right? Now, the SPS syndrome or the serrated polyposis syndrome is believed to be hereditary. No genetic defect has been identified to cause a SPS in most of the cases. In rarity, it is a genetic origin. Here, what you find is that this instability pathway contributes to the development of 15 to 30%. So basically, the epigenetic instability pathway is at work in only a small fraction, 15-30%. And these are those where you have a hereditary. But by and large, no genetic defect as such is seen, a transmissible genetic defect is seen to be passing from one stage to the other. Now, coming to these adenomas further, prevalence in the first degree relative. So if I have it, my child or my daughter would be at double the risk without symptoms. Without symptoms. The chances are that my offspring would be having the same disease without symptoms. And that is what is very, very sinister. That is what is very alarming. Why? Because you have to identify these patients. And they would be found more proximally. That means instead of rectum, they'll be more proximally in the ascending colon, descending colon, transverse colon, or even in some cases, small bowel. According to the grade of dysplasia, you will have to classify it as a low grade or high grade, which you just talked about, 20%, 20, 80%, more than 80%, or serrated. Malignant potential of a polyp on clinical examination would depend upon what? Number one, the sessile are more dysplastic and more premalignant. The pedunculated are more benign, number one. Number two, size, less than 1 centimeter or more than 1 centimeter. Less than 1 centimeter, the chances of having malignancy is very rare. Increase more than 1 centimeter, 10%. But if they are more than 3 centimeters, then 1/3 of them would be having malignancy or liable to change into malignancy. Histologically, we have already enumerated. So these are the factors or variables which have to be considered when you are quoting or mentioning a malignant potential of a particular polyp. Like these they have to be taken into account. So symptoms of these polyps, of these adenomas, benign adenomas, hematochezia, that is fresh bleed per rectum, diarrhea, and because of diarrhea, these patients will be having hypokalemia and protein losing enteropathy leading to hypoalbuminemia. Diagnosis, colonoscopic diagnosis plus biopsy is a must. Why? Because only after biopsy you'll be able to classify that polyp as a neoplastic or otherwise, and in neoplastic, which type of neoplasia. So it is very, very important when doing colonoscopic examination, apart from observing the size and the macroscopic pattern, you also take a biopsy to look for the histological pattern. The treatment of these polyps, excision if more than 5 millimeter diameter because of malignant potential, colonoscopy, and how do you do this excision? Colonoscopically with a snare polypectomy, you put in a snare and you snare it. EMR or endoscopic mucosal resection for larger sessile polyps. Transanal resection or TEMS, that is transanal endoscopic microsurgery. Proctocolectomy for massive and extensive villous lesions, that means excision of the rectum and the colon. And the complications have to be taken into account when you're dealing with these patients, and that is post-op bleeding and perforation. Now, coming to the more important part. So these, just now we have discussed the neoplastic adenomas occurring as a sporadic event. As a sporadic event, remember, don't forget this. All polyps as a whole, get this clear in your mind, could be part of a sporadic occurrence. That means they occur just by itself, one or two here and there. Or they could be part of a polyposis syndrome, whether it is neoplastic, whether it is hematomatous. Even in hematomatous, remember, we showed that three important syndromic Sudzegger, we showed the JPS, and we talked about the PTEN associated. So they were also syndromic. So all polyps in the colon, whether belonging to any group, whether it's hematomatous or it is neoplastic, can occur sporadic and they can occur as syndrome. So here, when we talk about neoplastic adenomas, they can also occur as a polyposis syndrome. Now, these polyposis syndrome are basically based on the histology, and the important ones is the familial adenomatous polyposis or the FAP syndrome, which is the most important syndrome, hematomatous polyposis syndrome, which we talked about last in the few slides, the three, the Sudzegger, the JPS, and the PTEN. Other rare polyposis syndrome, like for example, hereditary mixed polyposis syndrome, Gardner, Sturcott, PJ syndrome, Cowden syndrome, and we all talked about juvenile polyposis syndrome. So these are all chronic polyposis syndromes, both neoplastic, non-neoplastic, and premenopausal, right? Now coming to the most important and the most commonly talked about is the FAP or the familial adenomatous polyposis. Why is it important? The incidence is not very rare, 1 in 7,000 to 1 in 10,000 at birth. Autosomal dominant. Genetics, there is a mutation of the APC gene on the short arm of chromosome 5. That is the most important associated when you call genetic abnormality, when you like to call it a familial adenomatous polyposis or FAP syndrome. Now, familial in 75 to 80%, rest are non-familial alteration in the APC gene. That means, by and large, this genetic alteration can also occur as a sporadic event. It can also occur as a familial event. Male, female, equally involved. An interesting genetic alteration is also found in these, and that is a marker, which is the congenital hypertrophy of the retinal pigmented epithelium, that is the CHRPE marker, and found in almost equal, see 75 to 80, here also it's almost 75, 50 to 75% patients have an associated alteration of this gene, and that is the congenital hypertrophy of the retinal pigmented epithelium. Multiple retinal and chronic polyps are found. Lifetime risk of CRC is 100%. See this figure. That is what makes FAP the most sinister, the most feared, and the most talked about polyposis syndrome. Why? Because the lifetime risk of having a colorectal cancer in a patient who's having a FAP is 100%. He is going to develop malignancy, and that is why it has to be tackled prophylactically. How do you clinically define? You've done a colonoscope examination. When would you clinically like to call it that yes, this patient may be having a FAP before you go in for the genetic analysis and you go in for the histological analysis? That comes only later. So initial identification, clinical identification, when you find more than 100 CR polyps, that means you find studded polyps throughout the colon, first diagnosis, FAP syndrome. If you find duodenal adenomas, first diagnosis, FAP. So the patient has come to you with, let's say, some kind of upper GI problem, and you did a upper GI endoscopy. By chance, you found a duodenal adenoma. This patient never had any colonic presentation. He never had any lower intestinal presentation. You find a duodenal adenoma, immediately be alert, go in and do a screening of the colon by a colonoscope examination. So even if you find duodenal adenoma, you have becomes mandatory to do a colonoscope examination. And multiple extra-intestinal manifestations, in any of these scenarios, you like to call it a clinically diagnosed FAP. How do they present? Similar to all other polyps. See, the symptoms of polyps are all the same. Loose motions, lower abdominal pain, weight loss, diarrhea, passive blood, and mucus. Common to all. The only difference is the degree of presentation or the severity of presentation that will depend upon the number of polyps. So because in FAP, you've got more than 100 polyps, obviously the loose motion, the diarrhea, the passive blood, mucus would all be compounded more. Asymptomatic patients, if the patient is asymptomatic, I just now told you that these are patients like, for example, say he's got duodenal adenoma. How do you diagnose these patients? He never had any symptoms. So in these patients, you can go in for the diagnosis of the FAP gene, or you can go in for identification of the CHRP gene. Colonoscopically, in these patients, if you are suspecting this patient to be an offspring from a father or mother who had FAP, he is asymptomatic, you go in for a periodic colonoscope examination, and you'll find polyps in these patients as early as 15 years, but always before 30 years. That basically means what? That means that the surveillance has to be carried out in suspected offsprings, suspected to be having FAP syndrome up to the years of 30 years. In familial patients, polyps usually visible at 13 years. We just now said that. CRC develops within 10 to 20 years. That means by the age of 35 years, if I had a polyp, my father had a polyp, I am having an FAP syndrome, my polyp was diagnosed at 15 years, at the age of 15 years, be sure I will be developing CRC not later than at the maximum 35 years. But if I have no polyp up to 30 years, my surveillance was being done, I did not have any polyp 30 years, I cannot be suffering from FAP, despite the fact that my father or mother may be having FAP. Is that clear? Now, in new patients, that means sporadic patients, polyps usually occur at 9 years, but in these patients also, CRC would be developing by the age of 39. Carcinoma of the large bowel is way before 20 years. That's why it takes 10 to 20 years. So add 10 to 20, this 25 to 35 years. So before 20 years, it's rare to find a CRC. Does this have any implication, this fact? Yes, it has an implication. The implication is that if at all you want to go in for a prophylactic control of CRC developing at a later point of time, you have to carry out whatever treatment you want before the age of 20 years. Okay? Screening for familial patients. See, this is very important. Familial patient. That means identified father or mother or any parent or parent relative having a malignancy or FAP syndrome. All members of the family at the age of 10 to 12 years, they should be start having a examination, colonoscopy examination. Usually, you'd find by the age of 15 years, you'll be identifying these polyps. So do it every 1 to 2 years. If you don't find any polyp up to 20 years, go up to 30 years. I just not told you. If you don't have any polyp 30 years, then you do not require further screening. No colonoscopy surveillance required. You cannot be an affected individual. So remember, a patient of FAP, his or her offsprings should be having, even if they are asymptomatic, should be having a colonic surveillance starting at 10 to 12 years or 15 years at the most, every year up to 20 years. After 20 years, if no polyps identified, every 5 years up to 30 years. But if you find that these patients have a polyp at 20 years, then it has to be a yearly follow-up or a formal treatment of these polyps. Diagnosis of these polyps best made by colonoscopic. And I said earlier, the genetics to be done, the FAP gene, the DNA, and the CHRPES gene to be identified. And that diagnoses the FAP syndrome for you. The aim. So what is the aim of managing FAP? I told you 100% incidence of malignancy. So what is the aim? Very pretty obvious. Prevent the occurrence of CRC. And how do you prevent? Prophylactic. Prevent means prophylactic. So you do a prophylactic surgery. See the age 17, 18 years? Why? I just now told you. Below 20 years, having malignancy is very, very rare. So you have the time from diagnosis at the age of 10 to 12 years to 15 years up to the age of 20 years. At that time, earliest after 17 to 18 years, you should go ahead and do whatever you want. That is the time when you can start thinking about any kind of prophylactic surgery. And what are the options available to you? You prevent a CRC. Either you're going for a total colectomy. If you do a total colectomy, what do you have remaining behind? Ileum proximally and the rectum distally. So you do an ileorectal anastomosis, right? Or you can do a restorative proctocolectomy with ileal pouch in anastomosis. So either you do a plain and simple ileorectal, or you remove even the colon and the rectum. So what do you have left behind? The ileum and the anal. So either you do an ileoanal anastomosis, what's going to happen in that individual? He eats and comes out. Eats, comes out. There's no reservoir function remaining behind. There's no rectum there. So this patient is going to push everything out, would be having severe diarrhea, and would have need the support of a lot of TPN, that is total parenteral nutrition, and drugs and so on and so forth. So can you create a reservoir there? Yes, you can do that. That is known as the ileal pouch. So ileal pouch is nothing but an artificial reservoir created to mimic the rectal reservoir to decrease the incidence of the diarrhea occurring after a complete removal of the colon and the rectum. So if you're doing a proctocolectomy, so one, you did a colectomy. Okay, I did an ileorectal anastomosis. Very good. He has a rectal reservoir function. This patient will not be having recurrent diarrhea lifelong. He won't be having that. Why? With the help of medicines, you can control it. But if you have done a colectomy along with the removal of the rectum, in that case, either you can just anastomose the ileum to the anal canal, which is not a very good scenario. Create an ileal pouch and then do what is known as the ileal pouch anal anastomosis. The complications are there. Pouch failure 10%, recurrence are all there at the staple line. But they can be prevented by mucosal resection before you go in for an ileorectal anastomosis or an ileoanal anastomosis. Or you can do the patient, or you don't know how to do ileal pouch anastomosis, or it's not possible in that particular, you just remove the total colon and the rectum. Close the anal opening from top and do an end ileostomy. That is the third option available, right? So when you leave the rectum behind, remember, in any patient of CRC, any patient of neoplastic adenomatous polyposis syndrome, whether it is FAP or otherwise, if you're leaving the rectum behind, be sure that that rectum has to be properly surveillance. Survey has to be done. A surveillance regime has to be carried out. Why? Because invasive malignancy in the remnant has been found in 10% over 30 years. So basically what we are saying is that the preference should be removing the whole of the colon and the rectum. But short of that, if you're not removing the rectum for obvious reasons, you don't want the patient having uncontrolled diarrhea, etc., etc., then you have to have a proper surveillance of the rectum after every 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, depending upon scenario. Why? Because they would be having a change into malignancy in 10% over a period of 30 years. So that regular surveillance is required. The second group of syndromic neoplastic adenoma. So the first neoplastic syndromic neoplastic adenoma was the FAP. The second is a variant of FAP. Even with FAP, you got a full-blown FAP, or you can be having a variance of FAP where the primary genetic defect is the same, but with variable penetration. So you can have a Gardner syndrome, You can have a Charcot syndrome. You can have MYH variant, which have been identified. I'm not going to go into the details of what is the Gardner syndrome and Charcot syndrome. You can read it up. You can see the slide, and you can see what has been mentioned out here. The associated multiple organ involvement in these syndromes, right? The other syndromes with intestinal polyps. So these were the important syndrome, the FAP syndrome, and then you had the variants of FAP syndrome. Then you got other syndromes with intestinal polyps. Now these are both neoplastic and non-neoplastic. See Sulzheimer. Sulzheimer is not neoplastic, it is a hematomatous. So Gardner we already mentioned. So basal cell lever syndrome, Cowden syndrome, Sulzheimer syndrome. So basically what you're talking about, what you said, I specified earlier, was that in those patients where you have polyp, they can either be part of a sporadic or they can be part of a syndromic. They can be sporadic or they can be familial. So that is how you see the whole scenario of polyps. But by and large, one thing which should stick to your mind is that an overall incidence of malignancy in these polyps is only 5 to 10%. Fortunately, 90% of them are usually, 95% of them are usually non-malignant. But when you have a polyp, all polyps to be considered malignant or with malignant potential and should be removed. That is very important, despite the fact of those figures. But that 5 to 10% figure is very important. Why need those 5 to 10%? So in order to target those 5 to 10% who either have a chance of having later on development malignancy or they have malignant polyp at that time, you have to remove them and you have to go in for a proper histopathology examination and treatment. Now, what are the variables when you consider whether polyp is malignant or not? We already talked about that. 1 centimeter, the size, the multiplicity, or the macroscopic appearance, and the histological types. We already talked about that, so I'm not going to repeat that. So these are the variables to be considered, right? So what is the principle of management of a colorectal polyp? In general, we talked about the specific things. Let's talk about in general. Number one, advanced endoscopic using modification. Apart from the colonoscopic examination, you can also use the advanced colonoscopic examination. And these are magnifying endoscope, chromoendoscopy, or you can use a magnification endoscopy with a narrow band imaging, NBI. The aim, what is the aim? Site, number, macroscopic. Second, decide on the nature of the polyp. Can you do that? Yes, with the help of chromoendoscopy and magnifying endoscopy, just by looking at a polyp, you can decide whether you're probably looking at a malignant or a non-malignant polyp. Like example, mucosal surface architecture has to be seen, the vascular pattern on the mucosa, and if you have a submucosal tethering, you put in some amount of saline and the whole of the mucosa should rise. If it is not rising at one particular point, that means there is some mucosal tethering and the chances of having a malignant polyp is very much there. Endoscopic biopsy, if indicated, is a must. So what are the principles of management other than FAP syndrome or other syndromes? Because FAP syndrome, other syndrome, remember, there it is preventing CRC, so it has to be a whole full-blown massive resection. But if you've got polyp which is probably non-neoplastic, this is what a snare looks like. See this loop pushed in, and then you tighten this loop, it snares it. That's what is snare polypectomy. So if you have less than 2 centimeters in size, colonoscopic or transanal. Either you go through the anal, if it's a rectal polyp, higher up you have to do a colonoscopy. A cold snare polypectomy, or you can do a hot snare using a cautery, or you can do endoscopic mucosal resection. Preferred is always a cold snare polypectomy, right? More than 2 centimeters in size, transanal removal endoscopically with a microsurgery, transanal minimal invasive surgery, or a combination of laparoscopic or colonoscopic surgery, polypectomy, right? That is endolaparoscopic polypectomy. It's a combination. Or resectional procedure as in a FAP syndrome. And in syndromic polyposis, like for example, FAP, I just now repeated what maximal resectional procedure. So if you don't have a syndromic, if you don't have a highly suspected malignant polyp, then you can easily go in for these alternatives depending upon the size of the polyp. But if you're suspecting malignancy, then it has to be treated as a FAP syndrome. So the management, the complication, when you're doing this management, the complication is important. What are the complications? The incomplete removal, the chance is always there. When you're doing a snare, when you're doing a snaring, suppose you tighten the snare here, you're leaving this amount of stock behind. That would be detrimental to the further progress of the polyp, or rather to the further health of the patient. It can always be persistent as a dysplastic change in that particular stock. So the complications, incomplete removal, bleeding, and perforation are the three important complications, especially when you're doing any of these endoscopic procedures. In any polyp management, the post-operative surveillance is very, very important and required for 3 to 10 years, depends on the family history, depends on the number of polyps, the size of polyps, and polyp histology. So in a sense, in any polyp, when you're doing any kind of treatment, the guidelines for surveillance is important. Why? Because again, the aim is the same. Detection of CRC, prevent before it develops. So if you have a low risk adenoma, you've removed it. That is 1 to 2 adenomas, then 10 meter size. You have removed it. Do you need to go in for surveillance? Probably not. But if you really are concerned, after 5 years, go ahead and do one colonoscopy examination. But if you have 3 or more adenomas, or adenoma larger than 10 millimeter in size, and you removed it completely, even then, a surveillance colonoscopy at 3 years after the treatment baseline is a must. But if you have an incomplete removal of polyp, that means adequacy of polyp removal is in doubt, then a repeat colonoscopy is to be advised at 3 to 12 months to see how is it behaving. If you find there's no colonic polyp found after the initial examination, then again go in after 10 years. Don't be worried. This patient is probably not going to have any problem. Whenever you do the surveillance, remember one thing. It is both a surveillance of the pouch if it is created and the rectum. Both have to be done, and the colon. So all these things have to be surveyed. The colon and the rectum, yes. But in those patients where a colectomy had been done or proctocolectomy has been done and a pouch was created, then pouch also has to be surveyed. And of course, surveillance always also means upper GI endoscopy. Why? Because remember, we told you a number of syndromic polyps, colorectal polyps would be having upper GI polyps. So high incidence of duodenal ampullary cancers is always found in these syndromic CR polyps. So you have to go in for upper GI endoscopy. Now, I'm not going to go into the details of surveillance. You can look up the guidelines. But just coming to the potentially malignant non-polypose syndrome, this needs mention here because this is, again, a very important prevalent condition, also known as Lynch syndromes or HNPCC, hereditary non-polypose colonic cancer. Now, what are the types? There are two types. One is the CRC, 8%, 80% lifetime risk. Compare this to FAP. FAP, what are the lifetime risk? 100%. Here, 80%. That is also very huge risk. And at the age of 24, 45 years. Type 2 HNPCC is the CRC when it's associated with other cancers, like in females, endometrium, ovary, in either sex, stomach, and small bowel. So that is type 2 Lynch or HNPCC, and this is type 1. Autosomal dominant, again, remember all the polypose syndromes and non-polypose syndromes in the colon are usually autosomal dominant. Here, what is the defect? There, it was in the FAP gene or else in the modified FAP gene. Now, here, it is the tumor suppressor gene which is involved in the DNA mismatch repair. And that is MLH1, MSH2, MSH6, the three important genes involved. MLH stands for mutl homologue 1. The gene is located on chromosome 3, and MSH is again a gene located on chromosome 2. So you got two kinds of genetic defects, one involving the MLH and the other involving the MSH. Lynch syndrome, commonest inherited syndrome to result in CRC, even more common than the FAP. Remember, 3% of all CRC. Incidence development of CRC, 80%. We just now said that. Earlier age, we also told you that, 45 years. More common on the right side. Terminology, if DNA mismatch repair gene defect is positive, it will be known as familial Lynch syndrome. If it is negative, you'll be known as familial colorectal cancer type X, not usually Lynch syndrome in the strict use of the term. Results in three types of CRC histologically. See, 80% CRC incident. So what are these CRCs? Right-sided, poorly differentiated. Right-sided mucinous carcinoma and adenocarcinoma of any side. So this incidence of 80%, what are the types? They're specific types that we just now told you, right? How do you diagnose Lynch syndrome? Genetic testing, we told you MLH and MSH genes. Amsterdam criteria is important, and this is followed world over. Three or more family members with HNPCC related cancer, all these cancers we talked about, and one should be first degree relative of the other two. Two successive affected generations, one or more of these HNPCC diagnosed before 50 years of age, FAP has to be excluded, and the pathology has to be confirmed. Treatment similar to FAP, surgery, along with that 5-FU-based adjuvant therapy, and aspirin is prevented. Remember, this is the treatment of Lynch syndrome. This is not the treatment of CRC. Comparisons are important. If you look at FAP and HNPCC, prevalence rate 1% and 5%. See, so what we just now said, among the hereditary cancers of CRC, the most common is the HNPCC rather than the FAP. FAP is only 1% and this is 5%. Phenotype, more than 100 polyps, only few polyps. So one of the criteria for diagnosing FAP was, remember when you talk about clinical criteria, there should be more than 100 polyps. Here, only a few polyps can make the difference. Just 2, 3, or 4, 5 polyps. Doesn't require 100 polyps. Genotype, APC gene mutation there. Here, it is the DNA of the MMR genes we just talked about, MLH and MSH. Age of onset, in most cases, 20-25 years. See, 44. See here, 45. So this is earlier appearing, this is later appearing. Localization, left colon. Localization, right colon. See, left and right, that's the difference. Associated, bone, eyes, duodenum. Here it is what? It is endometrium, stomach, ovaries, other GI. So that is the difference between FAP and HNPCC. Transformation to colon cancer, this is important, 100%. And 80%. We said 80%. 50-70%. Figures may slightly get. Coming to the last part, and that is the malignant potential. So everything sums down to is that when you have a polyp in front of you, what is the malignant potential when you've got all these things in front of you? So you've done you've taken the macroscopic view, you have taken the microscopic also. So once you have a microscopic diagnosis in your hand and you're able to diagnose it as a juvenile. Schutzegger, hamartomatous, Conkite carinii syndrome, all remember hamartomatous polyps. So what is the risk of colonic cancer and hexagonal malignancies? Is there, but with low malignant potential. See, low. It is there, no doubt, but very, very low malignant potential. And in all these conditions, like Schutzegger, Cowden syndrome, polyps are occurring throughout the GI. There will be small intestinal polyps also there. And they're all autosomal dominant. So that is the whole group of low malignant potential. Group of moderate potential, malignant potential, are the neoplastic, and these are the serrated polyps, all serrated polyps. So you have a hyperplastic, which serrated pattern of crypt epithelium. You can have a sessile serrated. You can have a traditional serrated adenoma, which has got a stalk to it. In all these, the risk of malignancy is somewhere in the region of 5%. See, risk of malignancy is 5%. So serrated polyps are those polyps who have got a moderated malignant potential. But with a high malignant potential are all the adenomas. Remember, tubular 5%, tubular villus 20%, villus adenoma almost 40 to 50%. Figures are slightly varying from study to studies. But just remember, if you want to remember, 10, 20, 40 is a very good figure to remember. Right? That's why the range has been given. That's why the range has been given. Location of the villus adenoma, most common the rectum, larger than other adenomas, cauliflower-like, and often sessile. So that is how you identify. So in these, remember the difference between tubular villus and villus, I told you, is the amount of dysplasia. Less than 20%, 20 to 80%, and more than 80% dysplasia. That's when you call it a villus adenoma, right? So that is how you decide about the malignant potential of colorectal polyps. I hope I've tried to make this colorectal polyp, which is a slightly mixed up, complex kind of a discussion, slightly more rational, and maybe you'll be able to understand it better. For this lecture, I'll be uploading it tonight or day after. And for other lectures, I'll repeatedly telling you that you can go ahead and look it on the YouTube Prime and on my website. Thank you for your time.